Hey, I'm Mike, and if you've played Fallout, you know how awesome it is to fight radioactive mutants in the wasteland. But how dangerous would the nuclear wasteland be? On October 23rd, 2077, the Great War both started and ended. Somewhere between most and all of the world powers, nuclear weapons were launched, driving the world down a dark path of nuclear winter. The massive increase in radioactivity yielded the surface of the planet scorched, with most of the living creatures either dead, severely burnt, or mutated, and you have to live in it. It's hard to know exactly who was all involved in the Great War, but you could tell that whoever was, none of them restrained themselves. Based on the upper sizes of the atomic weapons available today, there's no doubt that the destruction in Fallout 4 not only can exist, but it could easily be surpassable. That brings up a really interesting point. How many nuclear weapons would it take to spin the world into a nuclear winter? It's theorized that if 100 of the largest cities across the world were targeted with similarly sized bombs to the ones dropped on Japan in World War II, the firestorms would eject enough soot into the atmosphere, causing a reverse greenhouse effect severe enough to drop the temperature in agricultural regions by between 20 and 30 degrees Celsius. But given the size of the nuclear weapons designed since then, things go from bad to worse. The Tsar bomb was detonated in 1961 and was about 3,300 times more powerful than the one dropped on Japan in World War II. The mushroom cloud was so big it could easily be seen from 1,000 kilometers away, shattering windows over 2,500 kilometers away. Shockwaves were measured even after traveling around the world twice. The heat was so intense, anyone within 100 kilometers would have received third-degree burns. To make it even worse, that bomb was dropped from an airplane. Modern-day bombs are launched on rockets. Traveling about 15,000 miles per hour, in a little over 18 minutes, an intercontinental ballistic missile can travel from Moscow to New York City. Even at the farthest stretches, a missile traveling at this speed could reach any target on the planet in well under an hour. Back to Fallout. It's easy to assume that since the war started in 2077, that the bombs would be much bigger than the ones used in World War II. So we're going to assume that the bombs are about 2.42 megatons, or about the same size as the ones used by Russia during the Cuban Missile Crisis. If the top 100 cities on the planet were attacked, each with a 2.42 megaton bomb, 48 million people would instantly vaporize, and another 123 million would follow suit soon after. Anyone within 20 kilometers of the blast would receive third-degree burns from the 5,000-degree fireball. At ground zero, the crater would be well over 122 meters deep and about 1 kilometer across. The combined blast would have a total energy of about 937 quadrillion joules. If this energy was converted purely into kinetic energy for the New Horizons spacecraft that we sent to Pluto, it would have been traveling 21% the speed of light. At that speed, it would have reached Pluto in only 19 hours. It took 9.5 years. It would literally be traveling so fast that space would actually bend and time would be slowed. So now you have some of the largest bombs ever created detonated in 100 of the most populated cities on the planet. What's next? If atomic weapons were dropped on the surface of the planet, things would be very deadly for a very long time. But the point of nuclear weapons and atomic weapons is not to irradiate the ground or the people there, it's to destroy things. As opposed to a surface detonation, atomic weapons are typically detonated in the air to increase the area of effect, but also to decrease the radiation levels on the surface. As the bomb goes off, gamma rays are emitted, ripping the electrons from atoms in the air. The pressure wave is so intense, it condenses moisture in the atmosphere, forming clouds. As the blistering hot air rises, it not only pulls thousands of pounds of dust and smoke to form the mushroom cloud, the newly formed radioactive isotopes are also pulled with it. The radioactive atoms are then picked up by weather patterns and fall out across the landscape over time. That's why we call this fallout. Sometimes this fallout occurs over a couple days, a couple weeks, but sometimes it occurs over a couple years, over a vast distance.
This is when things get incredibly interesting. As nuclear weapons go off, neutrons are absorbed by other atoms, causing them to become unstable, splitting into smaller atoms, which then emit more neutrons. Sometimes these byproducts also break down into smaller atoms as well.
As they decay into more stable forms, the rate of decay depends on the type of isotope. Some have half-lives of a few seconds, whereas others have half-lives of a few million years. In Fallout, there are radioactive mutated animals all over the landscape. Weirdly though, the super mutants are man-made. Creatures like the two-headed cow, the giant scorpions, the radioactive beetles, those were all caused by radioactive mutations after the Great War. In the same way the high energy particles impact atoms in the air, they also impact DNA and living cells. When parts of the cells are destroyed, it might replicate this flaw, generating a mutation. If the DNA is too damaged or the portions of the cell are critically damaged, then the cell dies. Think of radiation like an atomic shotgun, but instead of lead pellets, it shoots charged particles at about 60% the speed of light. Although the damage isn't visible, you're basically being liquefied at the atomic level. In Fallout, robots are not affected by radiation. In the real world, this cannot be farther from the truth. When a nuclear reactor needs to be repaired, a remote control robot is sent into the area. It then removes the part, tosses it in a corner, never to leave ever again. Once the robot replaces the missing part, it then has to go drive away out of traffic patterns to make sure that when it does die, it doesn't die in an area that might need to be accessible by other robots. Basically, anything that enters a nuclear reactor or one of the highly radioactive zones never is going to see the light of day ever again. If radiation kills robots, then what about you, the explorer? Well, if something can kill robots or circuitry in a robot, then there's no chance that you're gonna make it out alive if you're exposed to that much radiation. Luckily for you, you actually exit the vault 200 years after the explosions. Basically, any radioactive isotope with a half-life below 30 years would have decayed down to only 1% of its original amount, and an isotope with a half-life of less than 20 years would be down to only about 1/10 of 1% of its original amount. 200 years is a pretty long time. Most of the surface would be habitable again, except obviously near the crater and where heavy isotopes with long half-lives would still remain in high concentrations. I'm sure by now you're wondering about the irradiated humans. In the Fallout universe, there are ghouls which are basically mutated humans who have become immune to radiation. In real life, there's no chance of survival. Like Cecil Kelly, who was a chemical operator working with a plutonium mixing tank. When he switched on the stirrer, the tank formed a vortex and the liquid went critical, releasing a deadly blast of neutrons and gamma radiation that only lasted 200 microseconds. He died only 35 hours later. Radiation is a deadly state of matter, but to be fair, there are really safe ways to use it, and it could be really, really important to the future of how we operate as a civilization. So don't let Fallout scare you. So anyways, if you enjoyed this video, give it a like. If you want to see how some of the animations in this video were made, you could check out my graphics tutorial channel. Link will be down in the description. And as always, subscribe and make sure you turn notifications to on. Anyways, guys, thanks for watching.